And I'm very, very pleased today to be joined by a long-term colleague, Jeff Redding. And Jeff is a professor in the Faculty of Health Sciences and the inaugural First Nations Health Authority Chair in Heart Health and Wellness at St. Paul's Hospital. Jeff, it's great to have you with us today. I'm really, really pleased you could join us, and welcome to Changemakers. I'm wondering if you can start out by telling us a little bit about how your research focuses on COVID-19.
Yeah, well, we have a number of projects that we were fortunate enough to get funded before this all became a global pandemic. And so some of those projects are aligning themselves now with COVID-19. One is with the Tribal Council on Vancouver Island, and it's looking at the provision of emergency services. And, you know, it's interesting because a lot of the services and a lot of the social conditions in many Indigenous communities in Canada and abroad are already, I think it's no secret that they're vulnerable, and there's disparities in what we call the social determinants of health and also access to health care and health services. And so we have a number of projects that are aligned to that. But when you superimpose something like a global pandemic, it sort of makes those communities even more vulnerable because, you know, the social conditions and some of the comorbidities associated make what I called in the Washington Post a perfect storm for risks, you know. And so, you know, we up our efforts to kind of work in the areas of emergency care, emergency services. Ironically, and in a positive way, some of the attention that's been given by COVID-19 has actually resulted in getting more attention to long-standing concerns in our communities. So this one project looking at emergency care services is one that focuses on communications, on being able to get patients to care. Mm-hmm. And actually, there was a little bit of resistance before to using telemedicine as a means of care provision. But now with COVID and the social and physical distancing, it really encourages people to use telemedicine, which we think is going to be a legacy. You know, it's going to be something if it gets adopted. So people in remote communities can have access to care from physicians and nurses and other healthcare professionals. So that's one project. Another one we're doing has to do with what we call early life trajectories, optimizing growth and development, what we call the developmental origins of health and disease. So we enroll women of childbearing age into a longitudinal a cohort study, and we will track them during pregnancy to optimize their, you know, their course of pregnancy. And then when their child is born, we will hopefully, you know, most of the patients will be enrolled in a study that will look at optimizing their health and development over the next 10 or 15 years.
I am kind of interested, just to, if you could talk a little bit about how COVID-19 is affecting Indigenous communities in particular. I think that would be helpful.
Yeah, I mean, we raised, I think it was the 31st of March, where we kind of did some communications in the media about a couple of issues. One was the need for, you know, putting communities into kind of lockdown, you know, to carefully monitor people coming and going from communities in order to sort of stem the potential for the virus to be transmitted. And because, as I said, the social and living conditions with overcrowded housing and sometimes not access to safe drinking water and food security, those things make it a very challenging to, you know, to address an epidemic combined mm-hmm. with the health services. So that was important. I think we also did some media with APT and the Aboriginal People's Television Networks in the very early days, talking about the tent city in Vancouver, mm-hmm. various places, and how the people there need to get the messages they don't have computers and televisions, you know, or they need to understand that this is a life, this is potentially, you know, could end their life, and that it's really something that they have to pay attention to. And, you know, providing the basics of clean water for good hygiene and social distancing. So that went on to some media there. I think the most important thing was getting messages out to vulnerable populations, you know, because it was happening so quickly and a lot of people weren't really sure what was going on. And those of us who work in healthcare knew it was a very serious thing. So based on what was happening in China and other parts of the world.
You know, I want to return to the cohort study you're doing. Do you think, you know, as a hypothesis, do you think that the stress that women are experiencing while they're pregnant right now will have an impact, like the impacts of isolation, of the pandemic, when you start to think about the knock-on effects? Are you going to be pursuing whether there will be impacts for the next generation?
It's basically, the idea is what happens in utero can be expressed as chronic disease in middle age and diabetes and heart disease.
Yeah, it's been interesting too to watch the news, Jeff. I've been noticing how, for example, bands, some of the have been organizing, you know, food, you know, barges to bring food in, and much more kind of cooperative. And again, this kind of inflection point that's happening in communities, that, you know, perhaps there'll be new ways of doing our work, or people doing their work as a result of the pandemic.
Yeah, I mean, you know, one thing that you see on almost every news item are politicians talking about science. And that almost never happened before. And of all stripes, you know.
Yeah, I know you spent a number of decades in the area of public health. You saw the public health response to the SARS epidemic and other pandemics as well. I'm just wondering if you are seeing differences. I'm kind of curious about that in terms of response. I mean, the science being so front and center might be one area, but I don't know if you see other areas as well.
A global pandemic. I started off teaching my fourth year undergraduate students in health sciences about pandemics, you know, the cholera pandemics and the Spanish flu. And, you know, they're kind of looking at me and, oh, yeah, that's really interesting. Like, what does that have to do with my life? And before the end of the course, you know, we were all in quarantine, you know, and I can honestly say I never thought I would live to see a global pandemic. You know, I thought, and that's actually one of the things that I wanted to say is this shouldn't have happened. You know, if we had measures in public health, both globally and locally, this would have not have happened. We have the science of monitoring. And I think maybe one of the legacies of this experience will be that maybe in the future, the likelihood of this happening again will be reduced.
Yeah, it does seem that we're learning all the time. And there's a lot of natural experiments happening right now as you look at different, even in Canada, different provinces responding differently, different nations responding differently. It's going to be a treasure trove for public health sciences to kind of dig into these case studies, I think. I'm wondering, you know, Jeff, vis-a-vis this national strategy for research in the area of COVID-19, are you satisfied that there's enough of a focus right now on Aboriginal Indigenous issues? Or how are you feeling about that aspect of the science? I know you've been a big champion for research in partnership with Aboriginal communities. And I'm wondering if you're feeling like that's an integral part of this now moving forward.
There's a CanCOVID network that's been established by the chief scientists for Canada. And that CanCOVID network has a governance body to it. And I'm on that committee and we meet every week, sometimes more than once a week too. And within, you can join it, researchers can join it, you can see in your academic institution or your hospital or wherever it is that you work, you can join it, and it's a platform for getting information across all the research questions that, including Indigenous. There's a social behavioral group, there's also a clinical trials group, there's an emergency medicine group, you know, anything that having to do with this from a research and science perspective is, you can just post questions and people answer them quickly. And it's basically facilitated by something called Slack, which is, you know, an online platform. And it really works well. And you can post things there and start to have conversations.
That's great. That's great. I mean, you've been such a terrific champion for really pushing forward health research focused on pressing Aboriginal issues. So that's terrific to see that work, that advocacy continuing for sure. Jeff, you know, kind of blue sky question, you know, where ideally the research that you're doing right now, how do you think it can help inform inform us in terms of responses to pandemics, particularly with Aboriginal communities? What are you hoping for?
We just wrote a paper for the Canadian Journal of Public Health, just reminding people that there is a treaties in Canada that have to do, and part of those treaties do mention health. And one of them is the medicine chest clause, which is the provision of medicines in the case of things like pandemics. Mm-hmm. And there's the pestilence clause and famine clause. It's just important to recognize, even though I always thought of it, well, that's an interesting historical artifact. But nowadays, it's kind of relevant, and it's sort of famine and pestilence. And that was something that was commonplace before the work of people like Louis Pasteur. But now it's actually, it's even more challenging because the world is so complex and changing. And what happens in one part of the world happens in another part of the world in the blink of an eye.
Well, Jeff, it's been a real pleasure to speak to you. This series aptly called Changemakers. And when I think of Changemakers, I think of people like you. You've really made such a difference in terms of the health research landscape. So thank you for your work. And those viewing today, please stay tuned and join us for a next episode of SFU Changemakers. Thanks for joining us.